Now we're going to introduce electromagnetism and see what happens. The photon is massless, and similar to the scalar field, the Higgs field, it has a shift invariance. In the case of the photon, it's a bit more complicated, and we call it gauge invariance. You know of this because you can always shift the electrostatic potential by a constant without changing the physics. This is possible because Maxwell's equations depend only on the slope of the potential. But even more, Maxwell's equations do not depend on the time derivative of the potential. So if you make the potential also a function of time, the spatial slope does not change. Therefore, the electric field remains unchanged. But the energy we associate with a particle living in this potential becomes an arbitrary function of time. This is a particular example of gauge invariance, which is explained in more detail in the supplementary notes. Gauge invariance gives even more freedom than I'm showing, because we also have a magnetic vector potential to play with. I want to think what happens to the phase of a wave function if we can shift the energy arbitrarily. So we have our phi1 and phi2 components, which are waves. In other words, oscillations of our slinking. The phase angle, theta, of this around the phi1, phi2 plane is a function of space and time, px minus dt. Now, when we couple this particle to electromagnetism, I can make the potential any function of time we want at all. We can change this phase angle at will. So for one particular x, we'll see that after this shift, we have px minus et plus this function c of t times t. So for one particular x, we can choose to make this phase angle zero for all time. In fact, when we include the magnetic potential, also, we have enough freedom in this gauge invariance to make the phase angle zero everywhere and every when. In other words, we can redefine the electromagnetic potential in order to make the wave function phi have the form vacuum expectation value plus a real radial oscillation, and phi2 is simply zero. After choosing this potential, we'll consider what are the oscillations of our slinking. So we have our disk, the Mexican hat potential, and the vacuum expectation value V. Now, the slinky can only move in the radial direction. We have these oscillations, but the Goldstone modes, which move around the minimum, have vanished. The Goldstone modes have been eaten by electromagnetism, and we're left with the remnant Higgs oscillation, H. It's such an oscillation that was discovered by the Large Hadron Collider in 2012. So what happened to the phi 2 degree of freedom? Let's ignore phi oscillations for now. We'll take phi equals v equals constant and ask what happens to the gauge field, the photon field, a mu. Well, Professor Higgs wrote up the term d mu phi squared. And when we take phi to be this constant, we simply have the term v squared. This looks like a quadratic or bowl-shaped potential for the photon field, a mu. We've created a mass term for the photon. Normally, electromagnetic waves have only transverse oscillations. When we introduce this mass term, the photon acquires an extra longitudinal degree of freedom. Our phi 2 degree of freedom has reappeared in the massive Higgs boson. We now have spontaneous symmetry breaking in the relativistic quantum field theory. In the original Higgs model, this avoids Goldstone's theorem and introduces a Meissner-like effect. We shall see in the next section that having the Higgs vacuum itself exclude weak bosons with a Meissner-like effect makes the weak forces weak and gives the weak bosons mass. Goldstone's theorem also introduced a counting system for the number of Goldstone bosons. It was the dimension of the minimum of the potential that mattered. With the Higgs mechanism, this also determines how many gauge bosons can be given a mass. In our original Higgs mechanism, we have the minimum defined by phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared is equal to v squared, the radius of the circle. We have a one-dimensional circular minimum. And consequently, one Goldstone mode and one photon can be given mass through the Higgs mechanism. Now, we can consider scalar fields with more than just these two components. If we have a constraint phi 1 squared plus phi 2 squared plus phi 3 squared is equal to v squared. Instead of giving us the equation of a circle, we have the equation of a sphere. And we have a 2D spherical shell in phi 1, phi 2, phi 3 space. Just as the surface of the Earth is two-dimensional with two horizontal directions. That means in this case, we would have two Goldstone modes and two gauge bosons could be given mass through the Higgs mechanism. In the standard model, the scalar field has four components. The minimum is defined by an equation like this. And you can probably see that the dimension of this minimum has to be one higher than for the spherical case. So we have a 3D minimum. Goldstone's theorem tells us there should be three Goldstone bosons. And these are available to give mass to three gauge
bosons.
And you will see how this plays out in the next section.